on the rise, yeah, we on the attack. Young guns in the lineup, vets showing the way. NRG Stadium rocking to make our rivals pay. 2024 season, momentum at full stride. CJ slinging lasers, nickel running wide. Makes a pound in the rock, defense is like a wall. Lombardi in our sights, gonna give it our all. Steam locking down receivers, ain't no room to roam. Anderson rushing the passer, bringing the heat home. Stroud on the mic, orchestrating the drive. Taking deeps, breaking tackles, keeping defensive pride. Doubters gonna doubt, that's how the game goes. Texas 22 is ready to fight our foes. We built different this year, a team with heart and soul. Gonna grind out every new week for that ultimate goal. Mic check, 1-2-1-2. Here comes DT, Josh and Leo on Texas 22.
What's going on, guys? Welcome to the Texans 22 post-game show. The only ones that could see me dancing to the song is Leo and Josh, because none of you can see it before we go live, but I like to dance a little bit right before we go live. Welcome to the Texans 22 post-game show. I am your host, VT, a.k.a. Brown Chubby Bear. I have my two partners in crime, Leo, a.k.a. Leo is Forgiven on Twitter, and Josh, the Moco Joe. You can also follow me at Brown Chubby Bear and follow our main account, Texans 22 Podcast. Let's talk about the game. Insane one, 19-13 over the Bears. We now have a 2-0 record. What this means is we are leading the division right now. Now, we're going to talk about the game, but I just got to say, for the future right now, if we have a couple hiccups, we're leading 2-0. That's very, very important. I want to get your overall thoughts on the game before we go hitting stuff one by one, which we will. It's Stroud and the offense, defense. But I want to get your overall thoughts. Give me like a 1 or 2 minute synopsis of the game. Leo, you're up first.
Just again, man, Nico, like one thing we said before, in the pregame was if Nico Collins has a big game this game, we need to have a conversation about him. And I'm really starting to wonder, is he a top five receiver in the NFL after a performance like that? Again, people know who the number one guy is, and he goes out and gets 130 yards again. What else? I mean, Stroud, another great game, no turnovers, which is pretty much his best trait. And I think another thing, he showed really, really great playmaking ability, extending plays. Even that last play that got called back because of Titus Howard, who I'm sure we will talk about at some point later, with that egregious dumbass penalty, Stroud extends the play, runs for a first down, showing he could do it in a bunch of different ways. My last point is just like when me and Josh talked about in our breakdown episode this week. The front dominated this game. Will Anderson and Danielle Hunter dominated this game. D'Amico showed all kind of pressured looks. Man, it was just probably one of the best games I've seen them call since San Francisco. I mean, this team just has a lot of character and a lot of just, you know, physicalness. And I'm happy that, you know what I'm saying, we got these players that we have, you know.
Absolutely. I think the defensive line, honestly, we all have lots of questions. I was just happy the defensive line was honestly the strong suit. Josh, give me your overall thoughts.
This is the kind of game you have to play against a rookie quarterback. If you can't play this kind of game against a rookie quarterback and completely make his life a living hell, then you really don't deserve to make the playoffs. You don't deserve to compete for a division, and you don't deserve to just do anything of consequence as a football team or as a defense. And that's what they did. They did exactly what they had to. And to quote the great philosopher Dennis Allen, they were who we thought they were.
All right. So let's start getting into what went right, what went wrong. Because not just my opinion, I think all three of our opinions, we didn't predict a really close game. My prediction was 34-17. I forget what both of yous were, but I mean, we didn't come down to a 6-point game here. We were thinking it was much more. So Stroud, if you look at the stats, didn't have like a bad game in terms of stats. 23 out of 36, 63.8, so say 64% completion, 235 yards, 7.2 YPA, one touchdown. He took three sacks. Now, let's compare that to Caleb Williams, because we thought Caleb Williams was really going to suck. And it was bad, but it wasn't, like, horrible the way his first week was. He was 23 for 37, 62% completion, right? 174 yards, 4.7 YPA. Keep that number in mind, because that is really what he's doing. He's I think you were saying earlier he's a check down kick. I mean, he was checking down. Now, he was moving the chains a little bit. And then when he tried to make big throws, though, he either completely missed or had an interception. He had two interceptions, should have had three, and took seven sacks. Seven sacks. I mean, obviously, this may not seem huge, but any dude taking seven sacks over 300-pound dudes or 260-pound dudes constantly in your face, and we're not even talking about the hits. That's just the sacks. Insane. Leo, what are your thoughts on both QBs, on both how CJ Stroud performed and how Caleb performed?
I mean, I'm not going to be as nice as you. I think Caleb had a bad game. I didn't see he did good, and there wasn't that many egregious. There wasn't any egregious fumbles or egregious, like, turnovers. Where Stingley, let's face it, Stingley made a crazy play on that pick. Like, he basically made it look like the guy stacked him. And he didn't panic at all, which is why I think that – and if you look at it, Stingley also had to know that he had over the top hill. So I think they kind of baited that throw. Because I think on most corners, like, if that happens, like, he literally let him stack him and was right there. There was not one. He didn't panic. And like I said, safety's coming over the top. He plays the ball. It would have taken a hell of a throw to make that throw and catch. So to me, like, I'm not even the picks. It's just like, listen, I mean, he played good. You're freaking me out, V, with the stats. So I was about to talk about the numbers, and then my bad, I'm tripping. But basically, bro, it just wasn't a good game. You know, he didn't do enough to win. I'll say this, like he did take his check downs. You know what I mean? That's the only reason they was in the game, is that he took his check downs, because, you know, there was nothing open downfield. There was, like, you know, they couldn't really run the ball. I'm not really, like, I didn't see the great game that it was just okay. I mean, but I'll say this, like, his line got really fucked up, got really messed up the whole, especially the fourth quarter, bro. It was bad. They couldn't block us, you know? So.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. By the way, let me just clarify. I'm not saying he had a good game. I'm simply saying it wasn't as terrible as his first week, which, in my opinion, that first week performance was basically disgusting. It's like a Bryce Young movie, right? But this week just seemed like a normal rookie, as far as what I'm concerned. Like, his first week was terrible. He had less than 100 yards of passing offense, right? So it was terrible his first week. But I'm just saying, like, the difference between his first week and his second week, I think there was a significant difference there. But who gives a crap about that? Josh, you're up. What do you think about CJ Stroud's performance? A lot of people were saying he was off. What are your thoughts?
I mean, this is kind of what we worried about. When no matter what you have a receiver, if you don't have a run game that you're willing to attack, it's kind of they took a step back in the run game in a huge way. And it wasn't just in terms of, like, the first half, they had some interesting moves in that first scripted set. They had some interesting ways they were optimizing the run game with different guys in different spots. And but after that, they seemed to not really, there wasn't another evolution to where there was last week. There was a great plan last week in terms of executing, and it seems like, I got to go back and watch it, but it seems like they kind of threw a lot of the stuff out that worked last week and didn't even try for this team, because they just were so terrified of the edge rushers on this team, and they just couldn't execute in any way. And part of it was obviously Mixon being out, but even before Mixon went out, and I think that was big effect on Stroud being able to really only be able to throw to Nico. Other than Nico, and a lot of the Nico stuff was nasty, but a lot of it was really well schemed up too. So it was kind of a singular passing game, and he, like Leo said, what makes him elite is that he just doesn't make the big mistake that puts you in a bad situation. And it's pretty impressive. Like, any other quarterback would have had closer to seven sacks than to three for Stroud in this game with how they pass blocked at times. But Stroud is so good at getting the ball out quick So I think it was just your normal, like, floor performance for C.J. Stroud against a quality defense that kept everything in front of you and was going to limit big plays. And there's still kind of questions of Schultz not being a factor and different guys that we'll get into later and we can talk about. But when you look over at Caleb and how they played, I thought this was a huge step from how bad the secondary played last month. I mean, last month. It feels like a month after this game, right? But last week, it was a huge step with how they limited the big plays, kept everything in front. The few bad plays they had were the little whip route to against Stingley on DJ Moore and a couple of screen passes they had and this or that. But in reality, you saw a guy with Caleb where on that last drive, I was looking at it, and they hit that ball to Dunze. I said, oh, shit, here we go again. This looks like when Ridder was able to move the ball down the field because they're playing that stupid-ass off coverage again. And they were saying, oh, we're going to get rid of all the blitzing. We're just going to kind of just send four and play coverage because we're better than everyone else. And then finally, it's like someone slapped D'Amico in the back of the head and made him realize, oh, we've been blitzing. It's working all day. And he starts blitzing, and it was start, and then it changed. But in reality, if Caleb hits those two back shoulder throws at the end of the game, I don't know. We could be talking about a different result in this game. Despite how bad Caleb, and I agreed, he did not play a good game at all throughout this game. Like, the only times he looked good when it was a clean pocket and we were playing that stupid-ass off coverage and just giving him everything underneath, basically spoon-feeding him the offense. So, I mean, it was a step, but that's just because last week was such a dumpster fire, and I think it was also because of how they play defense in Tennessee. They attack more. That's their default. So that's kind of the baseline versus our default is we blitzed a lot more in this game, but he shredded us when we weren't blitzing. So it was kind of that balance.
Yeah, I mean, I think, did he even have a single completion when we blitzed him? I don't think he had. Did he have a single completion?
He was like 2 of 6 or 2 of something in the first half or through the third quarter against the blitz. But it wasn't good.
No. I think D'Amico really dialed up the blitz more, obviously, in the fourth quarter later on. But all right, so we'll get to the defense in a moment. Let's just get back to the offense because I want to shout this out. Holy crap, Nico. I mean, it's not just the numbers. 10 targets, 8 catches, 135 yards, 1 TD, right? But they're two different catches. It's like, who else is making these catches in the NFL, man? I don't know who. Thank God that we have him. And, you know, I was an idiot for a long time because after the first two of Davis Mills, I didn't know what he could do. And for those that don't know, I'm a big Michigan fan. So I was very happy when we drafted Nico. And then I was like, I don't know if Nico can do anything because after 2 years, he had injuries and really never had anything over 500 yards. But look at him now. He is definitely the best receiver on the squad. No, obviously, I think a lot of people thought it was going to be Diggs, and that's not the case. Diggs got 6 targets, 4 catches, 37 yards. As you were talking about, Dalton Schultz is almost like a non-issue. Like, I'm literally going to take him out of my fantasy lineup. Like, he is going to be replaced as a tight end. He's just, I think there's too many weapons, and he's not as big of a part of this offense as I thought he was going to be. 3 targets, 2 catches, 21 yards. And I said, Tate Dell. I don't know what's going to take Dell. He just seemed like he couldn't catch much. And I'm not saying every single throw was perfect, but they were catchable. And he ended up with 4 targets, 3 catches, and 3 yards. Let me get to you, Leo. Tell me your overall thoughts on the receivers and what's going on with Tank Dell.
I mean, remember how long it took us to like really see that we had that he was like great in the first place? It took us like 3 or 4 games. Like, you know, Bobby Slowick is learning how to use this iteration of the Texans just as much as like Stroud is getting used to Diggs. And then like I still feel like he's trying to just find a way to get Tank in the flow of the game. But because of Tank's size, you know, it kind of makes you kind of wonder, like, how do you really manufacture targets or touches for a guy that's 5 foot, you know, 8, 170 pounds, you know? So, like, you see him trying to do the reverse thing, which is just an easy way to get on the ball. But it's kind of like, the thing is like, you kind of have to attack downfield But then it's kind of like you kind of would end up manufacturing touches for Diggs. You know, like Diggs, if you use Tank downfield. So I feel like they're kind of in the flux, you know, and this was always going to be an issue. I think it'll happen probably by like week six that they figure all this stuff out personally. But I don't think it's anything. I don't think it's anything wrong with it right now. It's just like they're trying to figure out how to use them. And I mean, again, I would like to see the amount of like personnel that like heavy personnel. I still think we're running a lot of two tight ends, a decent amount also. So, you know, it's not like we're just setting in 11 personnel and just giving Stroud all the chances to push the ball downfield to begin with. So it's nothing alarming right now, you know, like for me, not at all. I'm glad that Nico's able to shoulder the load. The deeper we get into the season, the more like Schultz will become an issue for defenses, the more, because I think, just like, remember, bro, like last year it took like 5-6 weeks for defenses to adjust to how we were playing the game to begin with. So once people start saying standing too high and they roll coverage to Nico, like he's legitimately getting bracketed, it's only going to like Tank and Diggs are going to have big games. But, you know, just let the equilibrium of the NFL like kind of like figure out, okay, this is how the Texans actually move the ball. And then we'll just kind of see from there, you know?
Okay. Josh, your thoughts on the receivers overall, Dalton Schultz, but talk specifically about Tank Dell as well.
I think it's really simple with Tank Dell in this game. It's 100% to me that they were being way too cute with how they're trying to utilize him up in the middle, through the slot, and giving them in the run game and toss him the ball and all this shit. And I think it literally is this simple that he got hit too many times. And it messed up his rhythm or something. Like, and it's not a slight to him, but when you're literally that slight of a frame, like, what do you expect the guy to, how do you expect him to bounce back and be able to go out and run routes? Like, the whole point, it's like having Kyrie Irving and stick him in the post and throw him the ball. It's like, what are we talking about? You put him out in the Z, you put him out there in the deep water, you allow him, and Leo's right. He may not get a ton of looks at first, and he may open everything up, but guess what? You're going to put Diggs in his best spot. At this point in his career, Diggs can give you stuff on the outside, but he's at best in the slot, right? That's where he looks kind of what happened with Larry Fitzgerald late in his career, where you're best utilizing him with his quickness, his route running, because he doesn't have that downfield speed anymore to break away from people and to jump over people and do all that other shit that he used to do. So that it's really simple. Yet there still is that feeling out here, and I'm hopeful that Slowick will figure it out and get that together. But I think that's their money roll, and I think the more we see and the more they move away from, they could still use Stover as the fullback, right? But I think we also will eventually see Stover sliding in. This is why I said at the beginning of the year, Stover into that tight end one role and using him because he's a better blocker than Schultz, and kind of that'll be kind of your go-to lineup. But that's kind of my hypothesis on Tank Dell and what the issues have been.
Okay. Let's go to the rushing attack because it obviously was pretty poor. 22 overall, over everyone they used, 22 carries, 75 yards. The longest run was 18 yards. It just wasn't good. Joe Mixon had 9 carries for 25 yards, 2.8 yards per carry. These are horrible numbers. Cam Akers had better, but he obviously didn't have that many carries. He was also a different part of the game. You know, he had 4.6 yards per carry, but he lost a fumble. And like I said, it was in a different part of the game where they were giving up a little bit more of the, you know, of those runs because they're worried that Stroud was going to freaking throw the ball deep. But even his wasn't good. I mean, what was crazy is they used Tank Dell essentially. That's kind of as a running back here. 3 carries, 16 yards, 5.3 yards per carry. What I didn't like about this, first of all, is I didn't think that the loss of Juice Scruggs was going to be that big, but it was ginormous. Patterson looked horrible out there. Last year, Patterson held his own. He was getting crushed between players all the time. He was getting crushed. He was bad in the run game. He was bad in pass protection. And obviously, it wasn't just him. Titus Howard was horrible as well, but I will say I'm used now to, I guess I can't say used to, this is only second game, but you're looking at in the middle, and you see Scruggs actually holding his own, looking powerful. We can't have Scruggs out this long because Patterson is horrible. Leo, talk to me about the rushing attack. I know that you had a lot of stuff to say, not just by camera, because Damian Pierce, so let's talk about that on the show. But also, what are we going to do with the O-line? Because Patterson is not an acceptable center.
Well, I mean, remember, like, I had said all offseason, preseason, when we were having all these, for lack of better words, just crazy debates about Damian Pierce versus J.J. Taylor and Cam Akers and all these guys. It's like, if the play, like, we just saw an elite running back, when the plays aren't blocked well, this is what it looks like, you know? And that's just pretty much it. And you know, I told everyone there was games that we weren't going to be able to run the ball. And this was one of those games. And, you know, you kind of look at their team and, well, they have two edges that are like gargantuan, right? And it's like, when you can't just run toss and the defense loses the edge, and you know, you just get around them and you just run over them. Like, this is what it looks like, you know. This is just how football is played when you can't just pretty much throughout. I mean, most teams, you know, like most teams aren't built to run the ball in really tight spaces and just push a team backwards. You know, that's just how it is now, you know. Not that many teams have, like, you know, super powerful guards. Not that many teams have multiple 220-pound running backs. You know what I'm saying? Not too many teams have great fullbacks or great blocking tight ends. A lot of teams run spread now. So, like, to me, this is just kind of how it's going to be. Like, sometimes, like, I don't even know that Juice Scruggs would have fixed this. Because, again, like, I see Titus Howard, you know, dancing like he's at Onyx every 5 minutes, you know, on the ground twerking with his hands and with his ass in the air. You know what I mean? Can we just say that he's ass now? I mean, I'm tired of, he's playing guard, and I'm just tired of, like, an excuse for him. I have seen enough, and I just hope that he doesn't get my quarterback killed every week.
Yeah, Listen, I agree with you there that Titus Howard is definitely a problem. I will say that this, Jamal, I have to disagree with you 100% here. Fisher, I know this was in response to what do you do if Juice Scruggs is out. Fisher cannot play inside. Nick Caserio mentioned that immediately after the draft. This dude is a tackle and a tackle only. He gives a swing tackle, he can play left tackle, right tackle, but he's not going to play guard, he's not going to play center. That's not happening. But, We have an issue with the center there, I think. I also agree with you with Titus Howard. I think overall, the line was just bad. Josh, what are your thoughts overall on the rushing attack? And talk about the O-line. What was going on there? What did you see?
I mean, we saw flashes of this in the pass pro last game, right? When we had that stretch where we looked like someone had chopped off our head and we were running around like crazy and shit, and luckily we regained. But that same kind of mentality slipped over to the run game today, where there just was a lack of just anything in terms of just setting how do we say this? Okay, so last week, right, the mixing game that everyone was freaking out about, the line was good, wasn't great, it was okay. But a lot of things that the line did was Joe Mixon created 4 or 5 yard carry on his own, and the line was making blocks in the second level, where Mixon was already creating all this shit and making stuff second level to create these 10 plus yard runs. That's what happened last week. This week, they didn't even give him a chance to do any of that. They didn't run to have be able to execute anything outside of tackle. It was just a complete wash. And it was weird that they would activate a guy like Akers. Now, I don't think Akers is necessarily the solution, but you activate a guy like Akers and you don't start using him until really Mixon goes out. You don't really give him legitimate carries until then to build him up and kind of test it out early to know what you can go back to. Now, that's a mistake by a play caller and inexperience by a play caller, because you have to know what a guy does within the script if you're going to have a guy active for a game. So I think there was a lot of issues there, and I wouldn't be surprised if you don't see Cam Akers active for at least 4 or 5 games coming up because of that fumble. I just think that's the way.
Think he's in the doghouse, huh?
Put it this way. There's a reason Damian Pierce is on this roster, despite having a quote-unquote terrible, you know, kind of preseason and all that shit, right? Like, he doesn't fumble the ball, like, ever. So, like that's a big deal, especially when you have a quarterback that doesn't, and they value that so highly. So, I think they got to have a real, like, come to whatever kind of meeting and figure this out. And this, as long as the solution isn't using Tank Dell in the run game, I'll be happy with what they do moving forward.
Okay. Before we talk about our defense, I just want to go over the stats with the Bears defense because we've been talking about the O-line. So the Bears defense had 3 sacks, 6 tackles for loss, 5 pass deflections, 4 QB hits. That was pretty bad for what we're used to, but I just got to say we dominated them. Overall, the Texans had 7 sacks, 9 tackles for loss, 3 pass deflections, 2 interceptions, 11 QB hits. Caleb is really going to be hurt tomorrow morning. Like, that was, especially in the second half, dominating. And just physicality, just dominating. You know how we talked about in the offseason that D'Amico wants every quarterback to hurt when they leave NRG? That's happened tonight. Who got the sacks? Henry Toa-Toa. People hated him, right, because he was horrible last season. Dude lost a little bit of, lost, I don't know how much weight, but he lost weight. He's athletic. He's making tackles. He's not missing tackles the way that he was before. He looks really good. Azeez Al-Shaair obviously looks good. We're going to talk about what happened in a moment with him. Daniil Hunter had 1.5 sacks. Will Anderson had 1.5 sacks. Mario Edwards Jr. had a sack. I mean, incredible. We actually got after the quarterback a lot in the second half. Interceptions, Kamari Lasser and Derek Stingley Jr. Derek Stingley Jr. did get beat by Moore in the beginning, but then he came back and had the INT. Kamari Lasser should have had 2, but you had that, you know, that stupid penalty, which I don't even know if I would have called that as a hold. I know it was on Henry Toa-Toa too, but I don't even think I would have called it a hold. Leo, what did you think overall as our defense? I know that we were all talking in the chat, and so I know a lot of people in the chat are watching too, so talk about what you saw on the defense. Do you think people were a little too harsh on Derek Stingley because he didn't look necessarily fantastic all the time? But, like, hey, listen, this is what the show's about. What are your feelings on the defense? No, that's not
even, you know, I understand people going to say what they're going to say, but it just doesn't make it right. And it's just like, man, it's just reactionary. It's like every time he gets beat, it's like, oh, my God, there's something wrong, bro. Like, dude. I mean, DJ Moore, I don't think people understand how good of a receiver DJ Moore is. Like, DJ Moore is on the plane of, like, of any top receiver in the NFL right now, DJ Moore is comparable to them. So, like, you get basically a 220-pound man run a whip route, you know what I'm saying? Like, and change direction that fast. Like, and, you know, like, what the hell? I mean, it looked like a slant. He sold that he was running a slant. Like, there's nothing that Stingley really could have did outside of just punch him in the damn face as soon as the ball would snap to stop that. I mean, that's a great player there. So, I mean, when you play corner, bro, like, people are going to get that. Like, you're not going to just, you know, pitch a shutout every single time. So, and then there was one deep out route, I think, that happened. And then from there, it's like, oh, Stingley is this and that. And it's like, bro, like, just stop it, man. Just, like, you know, the dude is going to – he's going to do this to, like, 95 – there's a reason they paid him all that money. And then I saw some stat – I can't remember it right now, but it was, like, guys that have had so many yards in their first 5 seasons, dog. And, bro, DJ Moore was up there with, like, Jerry Rice and Randy Moss and those type of guys. So it's like, bro, like – just come on, man. Like, just stop it. You know, just this. He's a great player. On the other side, Lassiter, man, there was. I mean, it seemed like in every group chat from teams from wherever. The only reason they know Kamari Lassiter is because of his terrible 40 time, right? So now every time someone makes a play on Kamari Lassiter, it's, oh, there goes sorry ass Kamari Lassiter. He's like, he's the joke of the NFL, and it's like, well. Show me where he actually really just looked ass today. I mean, like, corners get beat, y'all. Like, this isn't 2005. You can't lug people all down the field. And, I mean, they ended up making plays and forcing turnovers. And listen, while everyone was complaining, Caleb was on pace for like 180 yards or something crazy. Less than 185 yards. And people were talking about our secondary look bad. I don't get it, but, you know, and it is what it is, you know.
I will say this. Before Josh goes, I will say this. I'm so used to Stingley because of last year. Stingley is literally elite, right? And we haven't seen him miss like that last year. I don't think we saw that once last year. Oh, he slipped. He slipped on the turf last year. That was like the only reason why he made a mistake. Now, this was the first time we saw him get beat. People like, what the hell's going on? So that I can understand. I will say you are mostly right. There was no receiver on the Bears that had 100 yards. I mean, DJ Moore had 53 yards. That was the number one receiver on the Bears.
But V, like, Zay Flowers beat Stingley several times in the playoff game. I mean, you know, like he's got him. Every corner gets beat, bro. It just is what it is. Like, I don't – like, did he get exposed? Like, did it look like he was unplayable? Was he getting picked on? I did not see that at all, you know, from either one of them. That's all I'm saying. Like, I'm not going to dispute the fact that he got beat. He did get beat. But it's okay. You know, that's all it is.
All right. Josh, I want you to talk about the defense and the secondary. Do you agree with Jalen Johnson? He said the defense was great, the offense not so much. What are your feelings about that?
Yeah, I think this was obviously Toa's best game of his career, and we were joking in the chat that this is Bama Hank, you know, Bama Hank Toa, because he just looked straight up like he was back in Bama, just very decisive. He doesn't look a ton more athletic. I know people are saying that, but to me, it's just all mental. It's all decisiveness. It's all technique. It's all footwork. It's all vision. It's all the things that he did that made him drafted when he got drafted in the draft. And there's nothing like it. It's really good to see him play downhill and attack the way he did. And I think what helped with that was how much they were blitzing him, how much they were allowing him to tilt going forward. And it was similar to why Petrie had such a great game too, sliding over the next guys. Like, it was a game that was tailor-made. It was super similar. Guess what? Petrie plays well. Guess where we're running? A lot more man. Hint, hint. Like, this is what we killed Anthony Richardson with. That's why Richardson didn't have a damn completion against us, too. Last game, playing man, and we had a pick, right? It's the same thing. They learned from it. They transitioned over. We played a lot of two-high man. Now, did I wish that we were playing tighter coverage? Yes, but obviously the point was that we decided coming in, we were not going to give up anything big play over the top against us. So we were going to sit in too high man. We knew they couldn't run if to save their damn life. And we'd keep everything in front of us. And if they beat us on a little stupid-ass wiggle route or a out route on the one of the best corners and most talented corners since Deion Sanders to grace the earth, then, oh my God, I think it's going to be okay. And then other side with Lassiter, He played his butt off. He did what he had to. He played physical. He had people think that he had an angle, and then went up and took the ball away. He stacked people. This is the kind of coverage that he wants to play. Like, he wants to play that kind of man to man where he can be super aggressive, play with inside leverage at times, play with outside leverage, force things inside, just do a lot of different stuff where you can box people out, and that's what we got to finally see. And I think moving forward, you're going to see more and more of this, especially when you look at the fact that I think we definitely dodged a bullet without having to play Keenan Allen this game. Because a lot of those sacks that we had with Caleb and a lot of those plays where there was no hot route or there was no check down, there was no yards after catch, like he would have been the answer to a lot of it. I think we probably get 3 or 4 sacks instead of 7 if we're playing it. It probably might even be enough to potentially flip the game the other way and turn it the way we played throughout this game and the way their defense played against us. But and the one guy defensively that we have to mention that had his coming out party for the Texans was the way Danielle Hunter and Will Anderson, both of them really, like, they just combined and were just taking turns. I don't know how to say it without saying shit that'll get us get the video kind of canceled or something, but it was just bad, man. They were just taking turns on this dude, and just that one play where he launched his body across DeMarcus Ware or something, or Von Miller. It's like, good Lord. I mean, I think at this point, and the best thing of the whole game was that we didn't once have to mention Jimmy Ward in coverage and didn't have to mention him doing anything, because they said, you know what, we're not going to let that happen again. And D'Amico was a man of his word. God bless D'Amico Ryans.
All right. Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, we really didn't have any complaints about that. Overall, here's a comparison if you guys want to know, like, where we actually compared into the Bears, right? Because I think most of us feel like we're a much better team than the Bears, and that's why some of this is just a little puzzling, right? So we had 75 total rushing yards. The Bears had 71. Both teams had 15 first downs. The Texans had a rate of 28.5% on their third downs. That's 4 out of 14. Now, that's not bad. Like, I'll tell you this. We were in the 20% with Davis Mills, and then when CJ got here, we got almost a 40%. 30% is really what you have to be at in order to beat teams in the NFL. It's not as horrible as it looks, but the Bears were better on third down. Now, I didn't factor in fourth down in here, but that's just the third downs. The Texans and the Bears both punted 6 times. Now, here's the crazy part, right? The Bears had 9 penalties for 60 yards, but the Texans had 12 penalties for 115 yards. We gave them the entire football field and then some. These penalties have got to be cleaned up. It's not just Laremy Tunsil, Foster, although that is a big problem. We're talking penalties, holding penalties. I'm not going to give Kalen Bullock any grief. He's a rookie. That's going to happen 2 or 3 more times. I'm not going to blame him for all of them, but 115 yards of penalties, we can't have that happening. Any time you're having more than 5 penalties and 50 yards, you're costing yourself a game. This is a big deal. We have to fix that. Time of possession. We lost time of possession. The Bears had 31 minutes and 13 seconds. We had 28 minutes and 47 seconds. We can't lose time of possession, but we couldn't run the ball, and so we won the way we did. And you know who we up the hill? Kymie Fairman. He had 4 out of 4 with the 59-yard field goal. Kymie is the hero. Leo, what are your overall thoughts on the comparison of what I just said between the Texans and the Bears?
Yeah, I mean, I'm still just wondering how we're going to end up using all three of our receivers, because I think they were brought here to basically make the third down numbers even better than that. You know what I mean? And I still think that they're, like, Slowik is still trying to figure out how to use all of them. You know, and I know I said that before, but that's kind of what I just keep on coming back to, because I think he's just struggling how to – and it's not even necessarily Diggs. I think he's just kind of struggling trying to figure out how to get Tank Dell his targets, man. You know what I mean? And I think once that kind of happens, I think then you might see even more just Diggs just going crazy, converting the chains, you know. Jokingly, I call Michael Pittman a move tight end. I think that's kind of when you start to see Diggs in his move tight end bag, but he'll actually just be better because he actually is not limited by, you know, just whatever, however slow Pittman is, but whatever. I mean, we say Colts hate for week 8 or whenever that is, but, you know, that's kind of what it is. That's how I feel just mostly. I think it'll get better once we hit, like, right around, like, I mean, obviously before playoff time, but I think once we get to that stretch where we're playing KC, the Dolphins, I mean, prayers up for their whole team right now, but the Dolphins, KC, Baltimore, you know, when we get around there, I think week 15, I think we should have a really good idea of, like, how they plan on doing it, you know? So I think it's not that alarming. The alarming thing to me is the pass blocking, just the blocking.
Okay, yeah.
You know, it's like that. Well, I mean, that's all I'm going to say. That's, you know, we can move on.
I mean, so, well, let's not move on, honestly, because here's Noah's question. And Josh, maybe you can handle this. Nosh wants to know, can we start Fish over Howard? He's not the only one asking that in the comments. But what do you think is going to happen? Are we just going to let Titus Howard just suck this entire time? Will we draft another rookie that could potentially be better than him? What's going on there? Because right now we had two issues. Like I said, we had Scruggs and we had Titus Howard. Both of them were very, very bad. But Titus Howard was not, I mean, not to mention, he also had the penalty which took away the interception, right? So what are your thoughts? Do we play Fisher over Howard? What are we going to do?
Yeah. So here, this is how I would count. This is kind of how I would approach the right tackle position at this point, right? The first thing I would look at, okay, if you're honestly looking at Howard and Fisher, who gives you more in the run game at this moment? Like where Fisher is, his body, like he still needs to add to his body, but him versus Tunsil, good Lord, him versus Titus, who gives you more? Now, this assume it's Fisher, right? Let's just say it's Fisher. The other question is, okay, we know Titus can't hold up in one-on-one pass block game more consistently, right? He's basically lost that privilege. And so there needs to be a shift where there's help over. They have to treat him as if he needs to earn back the right to pass block on his own. So you need to have a tight end lined up on his side every play, which is why I think you could see more Cade Stover lined up over there. Or, I mean, you could do it with Schultz too, where he can knock into the pass rusher over and over. And the thing is, though, if you're going to do that anyway, and you have to do that anyway to make sure that C.J. Stroud doesn't end up in the freaking hospital at this point, like, why not go with the younger player that has the higher upside in the run game, that can be a movable player, that is an athlete that you've seen have the athleticism to play on both sides and kind of move back and forth? That's kind of how I would look at it. The other thing that most concerns me, and this is a weird thing, and it kind of freaked me out the more and more I watched Tunsil on the other side. Guys don't make these mistakes at this point in their career with false starts unless there's something else precipitating that, right? Like, I wonder if there's something with the knee where he doesn't feel like he's moving like he used to, where he has to cheat, where he's got to get out there quicker. And if that's leading to a lot of those false starts happening, because you guys, he doesn't all of a sudden, like, I would say it's one thing.
He's had his problem since we.
But this is the worst it's been in his career,
no,
though.
No, it's not.
Yeah,
no.
It is. That's what they said today.
No. So what they said today, he's the worst in the NFL, but not through his career. He's had times where he has literally had 18 false starts in a season.
Oh, okay. They were comparing it to last year. That's what it was. Okay.
Yeah. So he's had literally 18 false starts. He's at 9 to 10 per season. So this is just him. He's actually gotten better, believe it or not. The problem is he's having false starts at the most inopportune time. So it's not necessarily the amount of false starts, because he actually got better, but the times where he does have false starts is a freaking problem. Okay. Jalen says, I actually wouldn't mind giving Cade Stover more reps and help with pass blocking. Can we talk about some of the cool plays? I know we only have about 10 minutes here, but I just want to talk about some of the cool plays here. So on that 4th-and-1, we now are accustomed, I guess, even though it's all one game, but that Cade Stover is going to be a fullback. So they put him out there, a fullback, and then decide to throw to him on 4th-and-1, get and get it. How amazing was that play by Bobby Slowick? I think that was amazing. I also think that overall, I actually liked a lot of the play calling earlier on, to tell you the truth. Later on, I wasn't necessarily questioning the play calling, but it was obvious to me that that Bobby Slowick felt handcuffed because you couldn't run the ball because they couldn't run block properly, and the pass protection was pretty much terrible, so you couldn't necessarily have Tank Dell run the deep routes. I saw a lot of complaints about Bobby Slowick, what are you doing? But I don't see this as a fault of Bobby Slowick. Leo, do you blame Bobby Slowick? I mean, if you do, go ahead and you know, tell me what plays and
One thing I've noticed about Slowick is he will protect his quarterback. You know what I mean? Like, so I don't think he's doing anything wrong. You know, how do I say this? It's like if how do I say this? Like, you got to understand that the way I think, you look at how violent our coach, our head coach is, bro. Like, look at how our defense plays. You know what I mean? On the opposite end, like, so, like, I think he approaches the game like everybody is trying to take out his quarterback the way that he's trying to take out the other quarterback. So that will lead to some vanilla play calling in a sense. Like, you will get some run pass stuff. And I think at the end of the day, if you're having questions about whether or not you can block right, then I think that's perfectly fine. You know, it doesn't look pretty all the time, but, you know, if we would have lost this game, it would have, like, yeah, could we have been more aggressive at points? Of course. But we would have lost this game, one, because of a turnover that happened in the red zone. Two, because we averaged, like, less than 3 point yards a carry running the ball damn near, some crazy shit. So, I don't know. I mean, you could always question the play call, you know, but it is what it is.
Yeah, and by the way, yep, I get that. What Leo has said, and I don't know if I necessarily 100% agree top five. I don't know if he's top three, but he's definitely better than top 10. Where I put him in that, I don't know. So, yep, I did that. Is saying, I'd say it's safe to say Nico's cracked the Jenna Chase mold in his top three, period. I mean, he's definitely on that track. One more game where he's over 100 yards, and, I mean, he's got it. I mean, he's, as far as I'm concerned, he's our god as far as receiving is concerned. The real question is, can he keep this consistency? Can he stay healthy? But you saw last year, he's so efficient. 109 targets, 1,300 yards. That is something that I can't get over, because if you look at, you know, like Michael Pittman or even Stephon Diggs, they're getting 150 targets to get 1,100 yards even. Not even 12 or 13. They're getting 150 targets for that. The efficiency is insane. He's making incredible catches. The question is, now that we are going deeper in the season, what's going to happen with his production? Josh, let me change the question, because I have a question for you. We're going to play the Vikings coming up, and they're 2-0. And they just beat the 49ers, who was a really good team. I don't know if you could say the first two games that we played, they're on par with how I want to see the Texans play. I don't think we're on par. Right now, we should be very excited. We're the only team in the AFC South that has won two games. But do you have a little bit of trepidation going into this Vikings game? Or are you saying, nah, we got this? You're on mute, bro.
Sorry about that. Absolutely. Have you seen how Brian Flores calls defense? Like, you think what D'Amico did was crazy? Like, this, that's a walk in the park. That's like chilled Brian Flores, right? Like, we got to really figure this shit out and fast, but going into that game. Now, the thing is, I'm pretty sure Jefferson's hurt, and I don't know if he'll play or not, but that's a whole nother thing. Hopefully we get to see that matchup, but I hope we figure it out and win. But I mean, it'd be great if he didn't play. That'd be great. That'd be a walk in the park damn near. But I mean, Kevin O'Connell knows how to scheme up offense, but man, that's the part that scares the shit out of me. Like, there's real, like come to whatever moments that would need to happen in that locker room during this break. And I think that's why we didn't see Scruggs in this game, right? Like, I think they knew damn sure that he had to be healthy for next week. They couldn't screw around, because if he wasn't healthy for next week, there's not a chance in hell that we're able to kind of have a legitimate shot to play and beat the Vikings, really, with how well they're playing at this moment right now, or at least compete with them, right? I mean, and you're going to possibly have injuries that could set you up long-term for the rest of the season that would really screw you up. So I think that's got to, I mean, the biggest question I have on that O-line is the way the interior is working together, Scruggs or not Scruggs, like the fact this is the second straight game where we've seen moments where they don't know what the hell they're doing. And like, I think Stroud covers up for a ton that we're not really talking about. He gets that ball out so quick, and he's so decisive. His ability to escape and create stuff covers up for so many things. And there's just a lack of athleticism across the offensive line in general that they got to really kind of figure some stuff out and really especially if now Mixon's not going to be 100% coming into this next game, because everyone knows who's twisted their ankle. It's great that he put up that comment right then. Man, anyone that's twisted their ankle, you can usually bounce back in that day. You can kind of figure it out. But, man, that thing swells up on you, and it's a lot harder that next week to kind of bounce back and do even more. So, luckily, hopefully, Pierce will be back, and they can figure it out. They have a full week. But to answer your question, that was a long answer, but hell yeah. Yeah, I'm worried.
All right. Leo, let me ask you, are you a little worried with the Vikings? And it's not just the Vikings. Like, let's be clearer. The schedule now starts to get pretty interesting. So, you know, the Vikings, the Jaguars, and then the first real, I would say, matchup, because we have a top five quarterback, is the Bills. And we play the Bills on October 6th. So we have the Vikings, the Jaguars, and then we play the Bills. How are you feeling right now? We are 2-0. So it's not like every single one of these is a must win. You have to feel good about that part. But overall, what are your feelings about the Vikings game, the Jags game, and the Bills game?
The Bills are banged up, man, and their offense is kind of like they don't really present any mathematical problems in their pass game. Like, they don't have multiple guys that need to be doubled and all that. I kind of feel their thing is that Josh Allen can pretty much make any throw at any part of the field at any time, despite where he is. You know what I mean? And so it just comes down to, like, just stopping the run and then kind of just, you know, just basically doing the same thing you did today. Because Caleb is – not saying Caleb is Josh Allen, but he has – it's the same concept, basically, right? They don't have the weapons that just scare the shit out of you. So not really worried about the Bills, and they have injuries on defense, you know, whatever, blah, blah, blah. I guess I'm worried about Von Miller versus Titus Howard, but we'll talk about that in 2 weeks. Make sure you're sub. Yeah. I mean, the Vikings, bro, like, I think Josh said, you know, it comes down to, can we run the ball? Cause here's the thing about D'Amico. I've kind of gotten to this point, and Slowick. They're willing to lose games as long as you beat them in a way that it's like, well, okay, like, you know, I'm not going to let you run the ball on me. I'm not going to make my quarterback go hero mode. I'm not going to ask my quarterback to beat Deshaun Watson, you know what I mean, and put him in the fire for like 40 times when I clearly see him running for his life. They don't really do that. And then, so, like, to me, like, if we can't run the ball well, we probably will lose that, you know, and if they get consistent pressure, we might lose that game if guys on the outside just aren't winning very, very fast, you know? So, yeah, it's worrisome. But, again, like, I don't know who they have outside at corner. You know what I mean? I think, you know, one of these games, Tank and Diggs are going to really show up. You know what I mean? And we just have to figure out which one is going to be. That's
okay. Yeah. All right. I also want to address this issue because people were asking in the comments, why did Aziz actually hit him? So he actually said that that there were players in uniform and players that aren't in uniform, and they were shouting things at him after the hit. And so he said he had to defend himself. He said it wasn't his proudest moment, but that they were saying disrespectful things. And he had and he said one of them put their hands on him, and he said he had no choice but to defend himself. So they're going to fine him. I don't think he's necessarily going to get suspended. I know people are saying he's going to get suspended, but if they look and they see, I don't know how all the cameras outside of the field, but if he got hit as well, I don't know. Maybe they suspend multiple players. We'll see what goes on with that. But he said it wasn't his proudest moment. He said he got. You know, he was getting hit, and he hit someone else. So, at the end of the day, I don't know. It's not the biggest deal to me if he doesn't get suspended. If he gets fined, whatever. As long as he doesn't get suspended, I'm not really worried about that. I want to end it on a good and positive note because we obviously won. So, I want to ask you, if you had to give the game ball to somebody, who gets the game ball? Josh, who would you give the game ball to?
Man, I could very easily say Nico, right? That would be the politically correct, you know, I'm going to go, like, the guy who literally won this game for us, Kyahmi Fairbairn. Like,
okay.
Without him, we don't win this game, I don't think. With how everything, we just didn't play well enough to, unless we were able to nail multiple 50-plus yarders. I mean, that was a freaking clinic, especially with the roof open. I mean, he earned his contract and more for that game. So, yeah, that's what I'm going with.
All right. I like that answer. Leo? What do you think?
Yeah, that's an interesting call for Kyahmi. I'm going to go with Danielle Hunter, bro, you know?
Okay.
I'm going to go with Danielle Hunter.
Okay. I mean, is it simply for the 1.5 sacks or because of pressure? Or give me a
I mean, just it just seemed like he, between him and Anderson, bro, they were just wreaking havoc, you know? Yeah, someone said Petrie. Man, what about the tone that Petrie played with? I mean, it was, man, I can't lie, bro. This is, and I mean, we've all seen the previous defenses that we had. We had some top five defenses in the league, but I don't remember Texans defense playing with this type of, like, just energy, bro. Even, like, with the
violence.
Like, say what you want about the Z's fight. Like, I'm not going to, you know, I'm not in the chat. Josh put I don't know if I should say what he said publicly. It wasn't bad. Fuck it. I mean, I'm already here.
Just say
he
it.
He said he looks like a dumbass, and I'm not gonna sit up here and argue that he didn't look like a dumbass. But man, was it needed, bro? I mean, cause like for so long, dude, I feel like we've kind of been this team that is like just like we're like even when we were at our best, we were a good team, and we might play very physical in between the lines of football, but dog, I mean a hip drop tackle, and then next thing you know, the defense goes out there and we're immediately like okay, if you want to play football, let's play football. Like you want to hit our guys, we're gonna go hit you. And I mean, I felt like it was honestly refreshing to kind of have like see us actually playing like that. It seems like they would actually go to war for each other. And I mean,
right.
I mean, you know, like, is it undisciplined? I have no problem taking, like, as long as it's not at the end of the game, like, I didn't really have a problem with taking those yards, at least in this instance. Not saying I want to be the Cincinnati Bengals with Vontaze Burfict or whatever. And, like, don't want to be like that at all. But, man, I was just happy to see us playing with that type of fire because I can't remember seeing that.
Oh, yeah. Just to clarify, I don't care about the hit. Like, the hit, I love the hit. I just now, he has now been marked as a guy who's mentally soft. And, like, he's going to get picked on. And he's going to get guy triggered. Similar to what they did with Chauncey Gardner-Johnson back when he was with the Saints. Like, multiple receivers were trying to flop against him and actually got him thrown out of the game. So, I'm worried down the line. That's the kind of – but, man, I love the – that was, like, straight-up Greg Williams, Bounty Gate shit, like, kill the head, the body will die kind of stuff, you know? So, like, I'm down with that.
But my bad, V, we're kind of going off the rails, but the same attitude. Man, Nico Collins, like, have we ever seen that, bro? Like, I don't think I've ever seen, like, first of all, some dude touched him in his face. He slaps the shit out of him, goes and scores a touchdown the next play, and then shoves the safety into the ground, bro.
Like, I loved it.
That was great, I loved it. It was perfect, man. You know?
I loved it, man. I gotta tell you. He literally put his finger right in the... What do you expect him to do? Right? And, you know, and then he says, TD and get the F away from me. Man, I loved watching Nico. That was probably one of the best things to watch tonight was Nico Collins. But I will tell you who I'm giving it to. Lassiter. Lassiter is definitely who I think deserves it. He should have had, like I said, should have had two interceptions. One was, I think, you know, it was a dumb holding call. It wasn't really that much of a hold, frankly, because you can. It's not like you can't touch the dude. You just can't hold them, and it wasn't holding. But in any case, Lassiter deserved two interceptions. He is a rookie. We all said he doesn't have great ball skills. And he literally, not just that, you know, he literally can catch the ball and have interceptions. All the people saying he's slow didn't look slow to me. Lassiter deserves a game ball because he's a rookie, because he affected the outcome of the game with the interceptions. And I gotta say, I love the draft overall. Now, the real question we're gonna find out next week is I don't know if we're going to find out until we actually play. What are they going to do with Titus Howard? I'm going to leave you all with that thought because there's no answer that I can give. But I will say this. Love Lassiter, not loving Titus Howard right now. Do we all agree with that?
Yeah. Yeah. And one honorable mention, too, for a game ball would be Toa Toa, right? Like, he balled out, and he was a big reason why we were able to stop the run the way we did. And impact player, great job by him.
Yeah, lead tackler for the night as well, right? So he's definitely improved. Fifth-round pick, someone we thought that in the offseason, saying if he doesn't work out, whatever, it's only a fifth-round pick. Yeah, I mean, he's showing up. Christian Harris isn't there, but thank God that we literally have Henry Toa Toa. All right, guys, thank you all for watching. Please go to Texans22.com and check out some of the shirts. You could see some of the designs right here on the screen. If you're listening to this in the audio podcast, visit our website, Texans22.com. We have all sorts of shirts. We have vests. We have water bottles. We have hats. We have all original designs. And check it out because I am working on some new designs that are coming out very, very soon. And we are giving out free shirts every single time that we have the pregame and the postgame if you guys come up. Thank you all so much. I appreciate it. We are 2-0. We are divisional champions. F the Jags, F the Colts, F the Titans. And just remember, Texans 22 always has your back.
Texans 22, breaking it down. Podcast got the city vibing to the sound. Special guests dropping knowledge so true. Keep the Texans down. This one's for you.